No letter, no notice, no pension. That's the message from Solent Waspy. And although they wear the colours of the suffragettes, the Solent Women Against State Pension Inequality hoping to keep their campaign peaceful and ladylike while bringing to attention the state pension age changes for women, an austerity measure that's having devastating implications for some women born in the 1950s.
For some people, it's actually being able to live, you know, to eat and to pay your bills. There are some women in other parts of the country that we've heard of who have had to go to food banks, for instance, because they're not getting their state pension. And people say, well, you wanted equality and now you've got it. That's no problem for us at all. We agree with equality. But the unfair way that it's been implemented is what we're objecting to.
A lot of women haven't been told about their changes to their state pension age, meaning that they got very near 60, thinking they were going to retire at 60, and then suddenly find out it could be 5 or 6 years later, which means they didn't have enough time to change their plans, both for work or their financial plans.
Despite passing the law in 1995 that effectively changed women's state pension age to around 63, the women most affected by it who were born in the 1950s were not notified till 2009, some 14 years afterwards, with very little time left to plan an alternative income. Solent Waspy say, and even then, only women born between 1950 to 1953 were sent letters. But then, 2 years later, the situation became worse as their retirement age was put back again by up to another 18 months, causing some women to be left in severe financial hardship as they were left without the weekly pension they'd been expecting and depending on.
The implications are quite far-reaching and they're quite serious. There's one member of our group in particular who lives in Romsey, and she's a single woman, and she worked part-time through her life as a further education teacher. She didn't have a chance to build up her own private pension, and she thought she would get her state pension at 60, and then last year she was diagnosed with cancer. So she's had to deal with her cancer diagnosis and the treatment. And although she's now in recovery, the medication means that she's not able to work. So she's got no income because she can't get any benefits from the state. She's not getting her state pension. And she's had to put her home on the market because she needs that money to live.
In June, Caroline Dynage, the Member of Parliament for Gosport, was appointed as the Parliamentary Under Secretary of State at the Department for Work and Pensions. That Solent asked her what the government is doing to help these women. And she said, I am very sympathetic to those affected by changes to women's state pension age and have corresponded with ministers to ensure that Waspy campaigners in my constituency have their views heard. Given substantial increases to average life expectancy, however, I do recognise that changes needed to be made to protect the sustainability of the state pension long term. This was not a decision taken lightly. I understand that the government explored a wide range of alternatives, but that none were found to be viable. On the issue of communication, over 5 million letters were sent to women affected by the acceleration of equalisation between January 2012 and November 2013. And in response to concerns about the time frame of notice given, the maximum increase under the Pension Act was capped to 18 months, costing £1.1 billion. This gives an idea of the costs involved, and I'm not sure that further concessions could be justified. Solent Waspy say that writing to women in 2012-13 who hadn't been told about the 1995 increase was devastating when some had been expecting to retire in 2014.
There are also women who have been divorced, and their divorce settlements were calculated on the basis that they would get their state pension at 60. So obviously they've dipped out as well because their state pension age has increased and that money that they were expecting to get hasn't been forthcoming.
The point is that people haven't had chance to make alternative financial arrangements, because if they've only had 18 months notice, they haven't had chance to plan or pay into another pension. I think another point is that because a lot of women have worked part-time, they may not have paid into an occupational pension, so they really are very dependent on their state pension.
Elaine was 55 when she requested a pension forecast in 2009 and found her state pension age would be 63. Elaine told us, knowing this, my husband and I decided to retire early in 2011. However, he sadly died in 2014. For 12 months, I received bereavement payments, but that has now stopped, and I find that I am struggling with only receiving half of his pension. Because of the acceleration of state pension age in 2011, I've got another 2 years to get by before my state pension date in 2018, when I'll be 65 and a half. I have tried finding work, but who wants to employ a 63-year-old woman with childcare commitments? Last week, a debate in Westminster sparked calls of shame on you after the new pensions minister Guy Opperman suggested retraining opportunities for older people, including the possibility of apprenticeships for over 60s.
It's not only an issue for women, it's an issue for men, and actually cross-generation issue, because men and women who live together, it's a joint income for a household, and if a woman isn't going to get her state pension, then that's a dent in the household income, and it's not just an issue for her, particularly in households where there's low income anyway. So it's an issue for men as well as for women.
The WASPI campaign group are asking that the government make fair transitional arrangements for the people affected. They're also making maladministration complaints to the Department for Work and Pensions regarding members who were not informed of the changes.
We're hoping that will go to the Parliamentary Ombudsman and that they will award some compensation. But we're hoping it doesn't actually get to that stage, and we're hoping that the government will see that we do have a good case and that they will just do the right thing, because it's a basic matter of trust, we think, between us and the government. And if we lose on this, then there's nothing to say that they can't behave in the same way towards other people coming up behind us. So it's very much a campaign for everybody. It's not just for women born in the 1950s. It's for everybody in the country, because it is a matter of principle for us.
It is fundamentally a matter of unfairness, and what we're looking for is justice for those women born in the 1950s.
Shan Robbins, VATS TV.